said his goodness is forever. You agree with that? Amen. It says his mercy is forever. Do you agree with that? And we sang the song tonight, Lord, you are good. Lord, you are good. Your mercies endureth forever. And yes, you are good, Lord. In every way. You have never failed us. You've never left us. You are faithful. You're altogether holy. You are righteous. It's your righteousness that is in us that makes us righteous people who have been chosen according to your purpose. You have by design created life in this world and everything that exists. Your everlasting love has kept us because you are love. And so, Lord, we learn to love and we love you because of your example of love, because you first loved us. And I love the story how Pastor talks about how a baby, when they come into this world, at that point when they're in that infant stage, they don't necessarily love their parent at that point. They don't understand what love is. They have a need to survive, and they're hungry, and they have needs that need to be attended to. And through your relationship and your interaction with your baby, your child grows to trust you. Your child grows to understand what it means to trust someone. And they further begin to understand what it means to be loved through your example. Even in times when you may get angry with your child, and those that have children, you know. But all of us was a child, so we know we all have a parent. We had a guardian, we had someone, and so we can relate that we begin to know that the one that's looking over us cares, our parents care, and we learn how to love. And in many cases, I remember as a kid, I would emulate and I would say the same things that my parents would say and that my mom and dad would say when we would go somewhere. Because virtually everything I was learning at a young age came from them. Sure, I went to school, but I spent time with my parents and I knew. And so their demeanor and their personality, I kind of took that on. And so if someone would come to my house, I was accustomed to seeing my dad or my mom. Hey, good to see you. Come on in. How are you doing? Love you. And I was a little kid. I was 8, 9 years old. If I answered the door, I would do the same thing. Hey, good to see you. Come on in. Love you. Come on in. Yeah, well, mom and dad, they're in there. And so I love that story how as a baby, initially we don't love, we need. And then through the example that is put before us through our parents, we learn to understand what it means to be loved. And through that relationship and that experience, we also learn how to love as well. And so I say that because I'm leading somewhere, because we know God is good and we read his word that says that he will never leave us, he'll never forsake us, and he's always with us, and we know that. But yet somehow, as we go through life, things come at us and situations come at us. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I've felt like, Lord, I know you're good, but I don't feel like I'm feeling your goodness right now. When you begin to internalize and look at your situation and you begin to kind of really feel the pressures of life and whatever it is, and you're looking at this thing and I'm like, it doesn't feel good. And I know you're good, Lord, but I don't know if I'm feeling that side of you right now. I know you said you'll never leave me nor forsake me, but I feel like I don't know what to do in this situation. And sometimes I feel like, or I have felt like, the favor of God that we speak about, I don't know if I'm feeling that favor right now in this season or in this time or in this situation. Am I experiencing his favor as I'm going through this thing that is beating me up? And if you're like me, I have literally allowed those things that are coming at me to really set in and begin to look at the situation and just let it set in to the point where it disturbs my peace. It begins to rob me of my peace. Sometimes you think about over many years and months, all the different things that can come at you. I've had times where I've lost sleep, where I've laid in bed and saying, wow, this thing is coming. I mean, I could see this impending whatever. It's upon me. And it literally, in some cases, kept me from doing the thing that is my victory, kept me from giving God praise, because at that time I was like, oh, woe is me. I feel hurt. I feel beat up. I feel like everything is crushing me, and I don't know maybe what to do in this situation. And so God has been working on Pat, as he's probably been working on you, because he realized who we are. He created us. He knows we're not perfect. He's not standing by waiting on me to get a little shaken by my situation and I caught you and come and beat me up. But that's not the way God is. He works with us and he meets us where we are. But he is looking for a people that trust him in the good, the bad, and the ugly. It's easy. I remember hearing times, when I wasn't going through a lot of things and hadn't experienced, and I remember going to church and hearing, you know, pastors and people say, you know, it's easy to serve him when nothing's going on. And I was like, yeah, I guess so. And, you know, if you don't have anything that's pressing, you got all the money in the bank, you've got your great job, you've got your retirement, you've got your great cars, 2.5 cars, 3.5 kids, 4.5 picket fences around your house, 5.5 bedrooms, 6.5 baths. You got everything you need and life is just great. You know what? That can put us in this false sense of security, like, hey, you know what? But God is still in control and it's still his air that we breathe. And so I've experienced things that have kept me up, and I've had to go back to God and work through that. The Bible says, work out your own soul salvation. I've had to work through that. I had to remind myself. And one of the pastors a few weeks ago, it may have been our pastor, was said, we need to serve and our God and look at him as the God that who he is, the God that created the heavens and the earth. And I've begun to realize that I don't have to come to God and educate him on my situation. He knows what we need before we go to him. He's looking for us to have confidence in him and what he's already promised and what he's already said. And so we can bring things to him, but he showed me how not to bring it to him in a panic-stricken form and look, Lord, I need you to, I don't know if you're sitting down or standing up, but I need you to hear this. This is big. It's a big one. I got to talk to you. I got to tell you what just happened. And he's like, really? But metaphorically, I've gone through those motions where I felt like, oh my goodness, I'm, you know, my back is against the wall and something needs to happen. And so I've gone to God almost in a at times in a panic-stricken state where I feel like I'm desperate. And I'm like, Lord, you got to act on my behalf. And there's nothing in there that represents trust or faith. It's me reacting on my feelings to a situation that's being presented to me. And God has been dealing with me over the years and showing me, and I'm not perfect now, but I've come a long way. And I know how now to get back on track, because I've discovered that believing in him is a decision. It's a choice to make. Just like if someone tells you something at work, say, hey, you know what? Last week I did this or whatever. You have a choice to either believe them, or if you know them, you may say, all right, great. But you may say, I don't believe them. And I know I've heard people tell me stuff about what they've done. And in my mind, I thought, I don't believe that at all. So believing is a choice, and we're in control of that. And God has given us the tools. He's given us the resources and everything that we need to overcome our situation. And so I look at Hebrews chapter 11. And so what I have found is that the best counsel that I could ever have either for myself or for someone is the Word of God. If someone come and ask me and say, hey, Pat, whatever, I got to take you to the Word of God, because I'm convinced there's no better counsel than what the Word of God says. It don't matter what comes out of my mouth. But his Word is alive, and it's sharper than any two-edged sword, and it cuts going in, it cuts going out. And so if I speak God's Word is alive, and it will illuminate your spirit. And so in Hebrews 11, first verse, it says, now, this is King James, and I like to look at it in a couple versions. It's just giving you a definition. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for. And we've all read that scripture. And it's the evidence of things not seen, of course. Okay, it's great. New Living Translation says, now, faith is the confidence in what we hope for. And it's the assurance about what we do not see, which is the basis for our entire faith. There's a New English Translation that says, now, faith is being sure of what you hope for and being convinced of what you do not see. God wants us, he wants a people that is convinced about what they do not see. Anyone can talk about what you've seen. We all see a bunch of stuff. But the New English Translation says, now faith is being sure of what you hope for. We're going to talk about what is it that we hope for. The promise, his promise, what is written, our expectation. And by the way, once you really get on board with this and you really get this down in your spirit, you begin to live by a whole other principle. It no longer matters what is coming at you, because he didn't promise that every day was going to be perfect. He didn't promise your life was going to be perfect. And he certainly didn't promise that your life was going to line up according to your expectations. But once you get this in your spirit, it doesn't matter any longer what happens to you, because we know the end of the story. He's given us the plan. He's given us, we have it all here. And once we begin to really walk in that and internalize that, it's a life changer. It's a game changer. Because you can get a call in the morning from whoever and say, hey, this and that. And you can hang up the call and say, Lord, I thank you, Lord. I thank you that it's in you that I live. I thank you, Father God, based on that call, that you're the one that's got the final say. How about that? I thank you that the creator of the universe is watching over me. And so you'll begin to have this expectation when you wake up that God is fighting for you. He's already created you for a purpose. His purpose is perfect in every way. And he didn't create you to leave you at a certain point in life and be like, all right, I got you up to November. And I'm, you know what? I'm going to be busy for a while. I'm going to have to leave you there. That's not the way. But we think like that. I know I have. I've gotten you up to a certain point, Pat. Hey, the rest is on you, man. The rest is on you. We totally act like whatever it is that we're faced with, that is gospel. And I know sometimes we get facts, but God is bigger than facts. There's a name above all names. I know sometimes we get information and sometimes we can see things, and we're going to talk about that here in a minute. But God has the final answer. It's a game changer. We'll begin to wake up and say, Lord, I know I got that report. I know they're saying on my job that they may end up cutting people and they're going to reduce half the workforce, but they're not the people that decide my success. They're not the people that decide my life. Lord, you are in control, and my life is in your hands, whether I'm there or not. If you take care of the birds in the air and all the creeping things that creep upon this earth, how much more are you going to take care of a child of God? Lord, I decide to put my trust in what you've said. And so many times we think of our faith as just believing in God. Like, hey, I believe in God. And I did. And there's nothing wrong with believing in God. Yes, we believe in God. We believe in Jesus, that he died on the cross for our sins. Yes, we believe that we are Christians and that we are called according to his purpose. Then what's the problem? The problem is back to that original verse that I read, and I'll read it in the New English translation. It says, now faith, and it gives you that definition. Faith is being sure of what we hope for, and being convinced of what we do not see. We can't see him. We know his promise, but not all of those promises have come to fruition. We're still, all of us are waiting on things, and we hear the term, we wait on the Lord. We're all waiting on something from the Lord with an expectation. And so the problem is, even though we have, you know, we're people of faith and we believe in God, when we come up across these situations, we see the thing in front of us, and then we're left to decide, am I going to just believe this thing that's right in front of me that I can see that's like right here? Or am I going to believe what I can't see over here? And the answer should be we should believe what we can't see. As a matter of fact, we need to stop looking at whatever it is that frightens you, and we need to fixate our eyes on God. So the problem is those things that are not seen. As we wait on the reality of God's promise to manifest itself in our life. And so many times we're in between, we're going through. But you know what? The military has these places around the country called proving grounds. And those proving grounds are where they test different equipment and machinery and all sorts of things. And they go there and they have to work it out. They have to work it out. And so I look at that space between when we end that sentence, it's the confidence of what we do not see. And as we wait on the reality of God's promise to be manifested in our life, there's that space right there. And that is that proving ground in our life. That is the thing that grows us, that matures us. That is the thing that allows us to see God in all of his might and in his strength as he defends us and as he comes to our rescue time and time again. That is when we really learn how to begin to, Lord, I really trust you. I lean on you. And I've discovered what I need to do when things press in on me. I have to jump into action. I have to take action and put into practice the things that are already written and the blueprint that he's already put before us. And so faith is really believing God in every situation. It's believing God even when our back is against the wall. And I've been there. I've more than once where my back is against the wall. I see the thing. I feel the thing. But see, David said in Psalms 23, verse 4, you know the verse. It says, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Now, why would he say that? It's because he knew that the Lord, his shepherd, would never leave him and would protect him and would comfort him. Because of his relationship with his father, he knew. Just like I've teased with my kids before, we've been at the store or we've been in the driveway or we've been somewhere and I run, jump in the car and start it up. And then, like, even my youngest one, she'll just be like, I'm not chasing you because I know you ain't leaving me. It don't matter, even if I try and back up and try and move the car. And I don't do it very often, but I've played a little bit. But they have confidence because they know my character. I've proven to them my love, and they know that I would never leave you anywhere, at a mall or a restaurant or wherever. I would never leave you. So even when it appeared that something else was happening, I'm just sitting here waiting on you, Dad. Then I'll pull up. All right, get in, hop in. So David knew that his shepherd, the Lord, would protect and comfort him. And he says, for thou art with me. We have to know that as believers, that wherever it is that's coming in on us, Lord, I'm telling you, just to say that with conviction will begin to change your attitude. Lord, I know you're with me. And that don't mean I'm not going to go through this thing. But if I go through it, you're with me. If I end up in the lion's den, you're going to be right beside me. If the people put me in a fiery furnace, the situation turns out that I'm in a fiery furnace, you're going to be right there with me because you'll never leave me nor forsake me. And you didn't create me for a dead-end purpose. Lord, I know you're with me. And so you have to start there. Lord, this thing is pressing in on me, and I know you already see it. And so I'm not bringing it to you as if I'm educating you. I'm just acknowledging that it's bigger than me, and I need your help in every area of my life, including this one. So I just give it back to you, Lord, because you know all. Give me wisdom to work through this, whatever it is, but I know you're with me, and I trust you with my life. And I don't know how, even when I don't see it, I know you're working. Even if I don't feel it, it has nothing to do with your plan. And I don't know how you're going to do it. If I knew how you're going to do it, I wouldn't need faith in the first place. I don't know how you're going to do it. But I know, Lord, that you are a way maker. You've been making a way since the beginning of time. You are a way maker. And so I begin to adjust my approach to the situation. I begin to adjust my attitude towards the situation. And I begin to take on a praise. And I say, Lord, I am so, forgive me, Father. I get silly like that. I don't know what even made me even get a little weak there. You are good. And your mercies endure. Lord, I just thank you. I thank you for your presence. I thank you that you're with me. Guide me through this thing. I know you will, in your timing and how you do it, and I trust you. So David says, for thou art with me, and thy rod and thy staff comfort me. It's literally believing God, even when you can see the very thing that is casting the shadow. He said, as I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Now, I don't know about you, but I'll tell you about me. Don't know about you, but generally, if I'm close enough to see the shadow of something, I'm generally close enough to see whatever it is that's casting the shadow. Matter of fact, I'll go on record and say, I don't think I've ever seen a shadow. There's a shadow right here, just from these speakers, and I can see what's casting the shadow. I don't recall ever seeing a shadow that I didn't see what was casting the shadow. And that's important because if a shadow by itself can scare you, and you've probably seen, there's been times when you might be outside walking and a big shadow comes on, you're like, what was that? A shadow by itself can scare you. And then when you couple that up and you see the very thing that's casting the shadow, you're like, man, this thing is real. It's right there. I see it. It's, oh my goodness. This isn't fake. I mean, I see it. It's in front of me. And so it is in life. All sorts of things come at us. And we have situations that are casting shadows. And many times, you may even be able to see, like I can, the thing that's casting the shadow, whether it's in finance or it's in health, whether it's in some other area of your life. And there's this thing that's casting the shadow. And you see the thing. You're like, yeah, I recognize what that is. And I don't like that. We have to know that God is bigger than the shadow. We have to know in our spirit that God is bigger than whatever is casting the shadow. Can we believe God when our back is against the wall? I had to ask myself that, Pat. Are you going to trust God? Because it's apparent that there's going to be times when your back is against the wall. And it looks like it may happen more than once. Are you going to believe God, Pat, when your back is against the wall? And every one of us have to ask ourselves that. Are we going to choose to trust him no matter what it looks like? Can we trust him even when we find ourselves in our own valley of the shadow of death? Can we have peace in the middle of the storm and have confidence in his promise that he will never leave us nor forsake us? See, the word of God says in Jeremiah, the 17th chapter, verse 7. This is just a new international NIV version. It said, but blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. See, there's benefits when you trust in the Lord. When you put your confidence in him, there's benefits. Jeremiah 17. So you have, now you have an incentive. Write it down. Remember that. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. It says in Deuteronomy 31, verse 6, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of them. For the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. You have the creator of the universe who goes with you, who lives with you, who loves you with unfailing love. God wants us to stand up in confidence and in faith believing. I've had to come back and say, Lord, forgive me for my unbelief. As a matter of fact, Lord, forgive me for insulting you. You have been so faithful. I don't have a record of you ever leaving me or forsaking me. You've never left me high or dry. You've always come to my rescue. You've shown me love when I didn't deserve it. You've always blessed me even when I didn't need to. You've always been there. And here I am contemplating whether you're going to help me through this new situation that has come up. Lord, forgive me in my unbelief. How dare I treat you that way? The King of Kings, the one who is always faithful. It's not what he does, it's who he is. And so I had to begin to reshape and rethink who God is to me in my life. Is he just this little God that we just speak of and he's so cute and he loves this little baby Jesus? Is he that? Or is he this God that is our deliverer? Is he this God that knows the heart of man? This God that knows what we need before we even ask? Is he the God that's, as one preacher put it, beyond? Is he the God that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think? If he's that God, we need to begin to treat him as that God. And I know this is coming bouncing, but that's all right. I'm bouncing. Lord, I serve you as the God that is able to do what I'm not expecting you to do. That able to come through for me in a way that I couldn't have even contemplated or came or thought about. Lord, I trust you. I used to say a few years ago, and there's still something to it. I used to say, Lord, give me the faith of a blind man. When I was young, we had a blind lady that lived with my grandmother. And whenever we would go to, and they lived in Akron, whenever we would go see her, wherever she went, she would hold on to whoever's arm. And she would just be right there. And she couldn't see, and she'd just go. And if you came up to a curb and you stopped, she stopped. But one of the things that was so, as I look back as a kid, that really impacted me now as an adult is just how much trust she had in the person that was guiding her. And if the light changed and they took a step off the curb, never once did she say, oh, are you sure it's okay to go? If they took a step, she took a step. If they stopped, she stopped. If they went left, she went left. They went right, she couldn't see anything. She was depending on their guidance and their judgment. And so I said, that's an example of being led by God. Lord, give me the faith of a blind man where I hold on to you. I don't even really need to see. I don't want to even see all the stuff that's out here because it could be a scary world to somebody. But it ain't to me because I'm holding on to the one who is the pathfinder. I don't even really need to see it. Lord, I'm holding on to you. Where you lead me, I will follow. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And so I'm looking at you, Lord. I'm holding on to you. When you say stop, I stop. You turn. When you take a step, I take a step. And so God has been working with me on this. And I thank God that he works with me. And he works with all of us. And I discovered out of all the excuses that I used to make that, well, you know, I mean, I trust God, but man, these people keep sending me a letter, whatever it might be. I trust God, but my car's broke down. I can't get to work. I'm trusting God. I'm trying to, but I had all kinds of excuses. But I now know that believing is a choice. And we have to make a decision, and we have to say, Lord, I choose to trust you over whatever it is that's pressing in on me. And I know there's benefits when I do. I know from Isaiah 26, verse 3, you will keep in perfect peace those whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. And so I realize part of my first line of defense and part of the first piece of the formula is, what are you looking at, Pat? Because what you're looking at is the thing that's going to give you joy or is going to make you afraid. Have you ever seen like a rescue team trying to, maybe they're, and we watch some of these rescue teams on TV, but I've seen either in movies or documents, but over the years I've seen rescue teams go in to either extract someone off the side of a mountain or they need to pull them out of the car or they're just in a very precarious situation and the person is panicking. And you'll see sometimes the rescuer will say, look, don't look down. Look at me. Listen to what I'm saying. Right here. Listen to what I'm saying. Grab my hand. Grab that rope. And they'll start to give them very specific. And they, no. I want you to make sure you look at me. Don't look around. Don't look down. You're 2,000 feet up. Don't look around. Look at right here. Do exactly what I say. And that's what God is telling us when we come across situations and we're looking, we feel like we're 2,000 feet hanging on this cliff and getting ready to drop. He's like, hang on, time out. Look, don't look down. Don't look at that thing. I want you to look right here. What does my word say? Hold on to him. He is our deliverer. And so now I know that, and I have to go back, and I'm reminded, and I remind myself, okay, Pat, do you have peace with this thing? Is this thing disturbing you? Then you're probably spending too much time on that thing, looking at it, contemplating it, whatever you're doing, and you've taken your eyes off of the master. So before we can even go any further, Pat, you got to correct some things because we're not going to get through this right if your focus ain't right. You can't drive down the highway if your focus ain't right. You can't drive down the highway looking like this. You will run into something. There's virtually nothing that you can do if your focus ain't right. You can't hit a baseball. You can't take a basketball shot. You can't throw a football if you're looking at the wrong thing. And so I now know that it starts with your focus. So when I start to feel that anxiety and everything, then I have to do a reset. And I have to get into my space. And I have to get away from my kids and my wife and everyone, because even around my kids and my wife and around even you or wherever I may be, that is not the solution at the time. I got something that's coming at me, and I need to get to the solution. And it starts with my focus. Lord, I got to get my focus back on you. I need to hear, and I've said this, Lord, I need to hear from you. I need to hear from you today. I need to hear from you on this thing, whatever. But I have got to hear from you. There's nothing better than a word from the Lord. And see, his word says in Hebrews 11, chapter 6, but without faith, it's impossible. Without faith, it's impossible. So we can't even fool ourselves. It's impossible to please God. And my desire is to please God all the time. Now, again, he knows I'm not perfect. He's not asking me to be perfect, but he knows my heart. And I want to please him, just like my kids want to please me. They don't want to do something that make dad mad or make mom mad. They do occasionally. It's on accident, and they come back and say, I'm sorry, and I have to come back, Lord, I'm sorry. But I want to please you. So in times when I feel like I don't have faith and my faith is being tested, I have to go and I have to revive myself by getting into his word and letting his word revive me. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And so we know that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So as we're presented with all of these life challenges, like we will be, in times when it feels like our back is against the wall, when it seems like we're walking through that valley, I've discovered now what I didn't know before, and where it used to frustrate me, now I see it as an opportunity to take him at his word. And now I find myself saying, Lord, I don't understand this situation, but I'm so thankful that you love me so much that you want to help me mature, and you want me to go from place to place, and you're trying to bring me to where I am. You're wooing me in, that you love me so much that you will allow me to feel these bumps and scrapes, just like the pastor tells a story when you're letting a kid, teaching them how to walk, and they walk and then they fall and then they want to sit there and they cry. But we know as parents that you got to get up, because you got to learn to walk, because I can't carry you. As you get bigger, I don't know, some of my kids when they were younger, oh my goodness, even before they could walk good, I was like, I can't carry you. Where that stroller? So you got to walk. And so they might fall down and they cry and they look at you. And I think Pastor Micah has explained as they look at you like, you're being so mean to me. Why don't you just pick me up like I want to be picked up and just attach me to your side and just carry me everywhere we got to go? Because it's not profitable for you. That's why. And you don't understand that now as a young babe and as a toddler and as an infant. But you will soon see, and one day you'll come back and you'll be thankful. You may never come back and say, Dad, thank you for teaching me how to walk. But in your intrinsically, you'll be glad you learned how to walk, and that you learned how to walk, and that you learned how to run, and you can do things on your own, and you no longer need Dad to carry you around. Dad, I'll be back. I'm running up the street. I'm doing this. Got to run upstairs. Whatever you're doing. And so now I find myself as the thing that's pressing in and casting the shadow, and I'm like, oh, okay, here we go again. I'm like, all right, here we go. I'm like, Lord, and then I start to get into my zone. Lord, speak to me. And then I start, scriptures start coming to me. Lord, I know that you have got it all worked out. I thank you, Lord, that you love me so much that you allow me to go through this for the testing of my faith. Eventually, I'll mature and I won't need anything. You know the scripture in Hebrews. So I've discovered this is an opportunity to take him at his word and say, you know what? I've tried everything else. I've tried coming up unglued. I've tried having a nervous breakdown. I've tried sleepless nights. I've tried everything under the sun over the years that you could possibly do. I've tried it all. I've went to counselors. I've done everything. But there is only one solution, and it's the word of God. And I say, now, Lord, forgive me for all those times when I tried everything else in front of you? Really? No. Today, Lord, you're my first choice. Tomorrow, Lord, you're my first choice. I'm coming to you first, Lord, because you are the only solution. And that's the time we exercise our confidence in what we hope for. And what do we hope for? What are we believing in? Trusting in the Lord that he will renew, that we will find new strength, that we will soar high on wings like eagle, and that we will run and not be weary, that we will walk and not faint. Lord, I'm believing in you that in your word, I'm taking it for what it says. And here's where you can just start shouting. Here's where you can start to give God praise right away. You want to get right up out of that heaviness? You can say, Lord, your word says in Romans that all things work together for good to them that love God and to them who are called according to your purpose. So even though I don't see it right now, and even though I don't understand it, your word is true and you're faithful. So, Lord, I thank you that this thing that seems like it's trying to press on me, you're going to take this thing and work it out for my good. I'm going to grow from it. I'm going to learn from it. And what the devil meant for evil towards me, you're going to take it around for my benefit. And so, Lord, I trust you in that. And I say thank you, Lord, that you're always looking out for me. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you have got a plan and that you have never failed me. And so you didn't say I had to know how that thing was going to flip around right now. That's where my trust, I choose to trust you. What am I hoping? That you will never leave me nor forsake me. What am I believing in? That he will wipe every tear from my eyes and that there will be no more death. There will come a time when there's no more death or sorrow, or crying, or pain. And all these things have gone forever. Where's my hope and my belief that what I suffer now is nothing compared to the glory that you will reveal in me later? Where's my belief that I am certain that God, who began a good work within me, will continue his work until it is finally finished? Because you don't start anything that you don't finish. Until it is finally finished on that day when Christ Jesus returns. And so, brothers and sisters, if you like me, we must remind ourselves that we are a people that walk by faith. We are a people who get excited about what we cannot see. See, to the world, that's confusing. That doesn't make sense. You're going to believe in something that you can't see, and you got this thing staring at you? It doesn't make sense. I once was blind, but now I see. 2 Corinthians 4:18 says it this way: we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. And so we begin to speak his word over our life in that moment. Lord, your word says in Isaiah 54, verse 17, that no weapon formed against me will prosper. Lord, I also know in Jeremiah 29, 11, you said, for I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all of your heart. And so I know that there's times I can see these things and they don't look right, and I have to readjust my focus. I can't stay there. Peter looked around and saw the storm, and he began to fear out of what he saw. He took his eyes off the master and began to look at the storm and the waves and the winds and the water, realizing, contemplating how deep it was, and like, oh my goodness. That was kind of his valley of the shadow of death. He could see the potential for him to die right there because he took his eyes off of the master. And God didn't punish him and be like, oh, too bad. Shouldn't have stopped looking at me. See ya. Of course not. It's not the kind of God we serve. But it was a learning opportunity for Peter. And we have those learning opportunities. And so we'll see these shadows that come upon us. And we'll see sometimes the things that are casting the shadows. And we feel like our back is against the wall. And there appears to be no way around our situation. That's the time when we begin to speak God's word. Say, Lord, I know I see all these things. I know the odds seem like they're against me. I know it seems like everything is going to turn out a certain way. But Lord, I trust you. I trust you, Lord. And I know that you'll do what you say you will do. Here's the flip side to think about as we get ready to close. You know, John 10:10 says, the thief cometh not but to steal and to kill and destroy. Jesus said, I am come that you may have life and that you might have it more abundantly. So there's two different agendas. The thief, the devil, our adversary, he wants to paint a picture. And many of those shadows are a picture that the devil is painting. He wants to scare you. And he wants to steal your joy. And he wants to kill your dreams. And he wants to destroy you. And he wants you to throw in the towel and say, oh man, all this stuff is coming at me. I'm just going to go back to doing the thing you delivered me from. And it ain't my fault. It's all this stuff coming at me. The devil's a liar. And he's the father of all liars. Jesus said, I have come that you may have life and that you may have it more abundantly. But you're not going to have it without him. The devil will whisper lies to us and he'll tell us, hey man, this thing is serious. No way around it. You heard the facts. What if it all falls apart? What if it ends up just like you thought it was going to end up? Better have a plan B. The Bible says, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Entertain him not even a thimble. Don't listen to him. And if it's in your mind, and I know that sometimes things pop in our mind and we've got to have a way that we get back on track and get focused. Put on our praise music, start singing, open up the word, start reading, put on your Bible app. But I've got to get focused. I've got to drown out the lies, I've got to drown out the noise. I've got to turn off the TV. I've got to hear from you, Lord. And I know that there's benefits to that. I know that once I begin to hear from you and I begin to hear your word and I begin to speak your word, faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. I'll be reminded of who you are and all that whatever will subside and you'll be back on track. Lord, today we choose to walk by faith and not by sight, Lord. We lift up your name and we give you praise in advance. We display our confidence, Lord, and our trust in our belief in your word and in your promise by how we live and how we walk. We walk with a heart of expectation that you are working it out for our good. We give you praise in advance, not waiting to see the solution manifest, but we are so confident that you won't leave us standing alone in the mall parking lot around strangers. We're so confident that we just start to thank you. Say, Lord, I'm just going to wait on you because I know you're good. Your mercies endure forever. I know you'll never leave me. It doesn't matter how hard the wind blows. It doesn't matter what the media say. It doesn't matter what whoever is saying to me. Lord, I know your character. And so I'm not going to insult you by acting as if you've never taken care of me. Lord, teach me how to display my confidence through how I praise you. As I go through the storm, if you were to see me walking through the storm, you'll hear me praising him along the way. And some may question, why is he so happy? Why is she giving God praise and everything is coming at her? Because I don't walk by what everything is doing. I don't walk by all the things that are around me. I walk by what the Lord God has said. And I know that he is good. And so, Lord, I praise you in advance with confidence, with boldness, that you're working it out. Not according to my expectations. I haven't created a box. You don't have to do it the way I thought or think you may do it. I'm just free enough to say, Lord, have thine own way. Let your will unfold in my life. Because I am convinced that whatever I go through on this earth and all the trials and tribulations that I might experience, they're not worthy to be compared what you have in store for me. And so, Lord, I fixate my eyes on the prize, which is you. I know the end of the matter. What do I have to worry about when I know the end of the story? So, Lord, I praise you in the storm, knowing your promise still stands. Knowing that great is your faithfulness. Knowing that your love is everlasting, unfailing. I will not complain because I know your promise to your believers. All things. You didn't say some things. You said all things work together for good. To them who love God. Them who are called according to your purpose. I fall in that category. I qualify. So I thank you, Lord, that my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I'm eligible for your promise and your blessing and for your reward. All you ask is that I stand in that confidence. I act like I'm confident. I treat you as the God that you are. I respect you, Lord, and all of your majesty. I see who you are, Lord, in your goodness. And I return that back to you. Keep me, Lord, even in this situation. Whatever it might be, for you, O Lord, have called me according to your purpose. Not to harm me. Not to harm us, and certainly not to leave us at a time when we need him most. There may be somebody who feels like they're walking through their own valley of the shadow of death. And they may even be able to see the very thing that's casting the shadow tonight. But I want to encourage you as I encourage myself. I want to tell you what I have to tell myself. Put all of your trust and all of your faith in a holy God who's a very present help in the time of need. And you too will be able to say, even though I walk through this valley, I'm not fearful. I ain't scared because, Lord, you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Your word is alive. You are true. You are the way, the truth, and the life. Today, Lord, I choose to trust you in every area. I will not fear. I will stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show unto us this day. Brothers and sisters, the Lord God himself, the creator of the universe, fights for you. He created each and every one of you for purpose. And he's taken you to where you already are. He loves you. And so he's working with each and every one of us. He's meeting us where we are. But put your faith in the Lord in every situation, in the good, in the bad. Find your scriptures that you need that encourage you. Find your songs that remind you of who he is and say, Lord, this flesh don't feel like praising you. This flesh just wants to ball up and say, oh, Lord, it's all coming at me. But I'm going to do the very thing that this flesh doesn't want me to do. Nail that flesh up on the cross. Lord, I lift you up. Even when I don't understand, Lord, I lift you up today. I give you praise and I expect great things today because you are great and you live in me. So that makes me great. I expect greatness today. I say yes to you, Lord. I am the head, not the tail. I am already victorious. I'm already an overcomer. You just want me to walk into that. He fights for you, and he wants you to trust him with all your heart. Amen? I love you. Let's encourage one another. Let's pray for one another. We all are in different places, and we all experience different things. And if God puts somebody on your heart, I learned that from my pastor. I never really thought about it like that, but a couple years ago, he was explaining that. When God puts someone on your heart, it's not by accident. It's not by happen chance. We have an opportunity to say, man, I need to pray for that person. Let me give them a call. Say, hey, how you doing? You know what? When's the last time we picked up the phone and said, hey, can we just pray together? I just felt like I just want to pray over you and your house and just pray over what God is doing. I don't know everything he's doing in your life, but let's just pray together. And we just start out, Lord, I thank God for my brother, Pastor Micah. Lord, I thank God for my sister, Miss Sydney, whoever it may be. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you've connected us for your purpose. And Lord, I'm excited about what you're doing in them. Continue to lead and to guide them. So as God put people on your heart, just give them a call. Don't be afraid to call them and pray with them. We all need prayer. Be expecting every single day the goodness of the Lord. We just sang the song, Lord, you are good. Expect his goodness every single day. He's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we can ask or think. And every day I wake up, Lord, you're going to do something exceedingly abundantly above all that I already asked or think. I don't know what it is, but I say yes. I know whatever it is better than whatever I could have came up with. So let's encourage one another. Let's continue to pray for our brothers and sisters that are not feeling well. He didn't say we would not have times when we don't feel well. He's going to heal us, or he's going to heal us. And his healing, I can't put him in a box. It doesn't have to come the way that I thought it was going to happen. So, Lord, I just trust you with every area of my life. Let's pray for our brothers and sisters. Lift them up. Know God is the restorer. He's our deliverer, and that we're connected to the one. I don't know what tomorrow may hold, but I'm connected to the one who holds tomorrow, and so are you. And so let's walk in that with a boldness. Let's be encouraged. Let not our situation paint a picture that frightens us. Whatever it is, there's a name above, whatever it is that's pressing in on you. And that's our King of Kings. I love you. I thank God always for the opportunity to just to share. Brother Terrence shared on Sunday, talked about the simplisticness of the good news of our salvation. And so it's so good to hear all of our different brothers and sisters just speak from their perspective and their experience and what God is doing for them. And all of you, even though you may not know, all of you, every one of you who hear me, you have, God has already put everything that you need. And so you don't have to figure out what to say. You just wake up in the morning and say, Lord, use me. We sang the song on Sunday that says, Lord, basically, I can't remember the whole thing because my mind is all over the place, but it was saying basically, use me, Lord. I want to be used by you. And so we wake up in the morning, we just say, Lord, I say yes to whatever you have for me today. And I know if I say yes, you'll do the rest. If you need me to speak to someone, you'll put the words in my mouth. And so just trust and believe that God is directing you. He's guiding you. And so it may be out of our character, but we are all together someone different than who we used to be. We are completely new. And so we don't have to rely on what we feel is our strengths and what our personality used to be, because now God has put something in us that makes us peculiar, that makes us different. And so it's exciting to walk in at and say, Lord, maybe I've never been that kind of person that talks to people, but I know, Lord, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So I say yes to whatever you have for me, because I know it's better than anything I could have come up. And so I just surrender to you, Lord. Use me. Prepare me. Let me be a vessel that's ready at a moment's notice. You can just, what? And I'm there. Where are they at, Lord? I hear you. All right there? Oh, my Lord, I don't even know what to say, but I'm walking over because I believe. I'm walking over in confidence. I don't even know what you want me to say, Lord, but you've never left me. Hey, how you doing? So good to see you. Yeah, I saw you over here. I just wanted to come over and say hello. I just been excited. And they're like, why are you excited? Well, he's been so good. He keeps proving himself over and over and over and over and over again. And he has to, because I have short-term memory. It lost, it seems like sometimes I forget what he did yesterday, so he does more. And then all of a sudden you're like, I don't even know where that came from, but God just allows you to connect to that person because he's already set it up. Their heart's ready. And he's just looking for a vessel that's not scared. It's not going to let fear hold me back. Well, I never really used to talk to people. He's not concerned with what you ever used to really do, because he's put something in you special now. And so all you have to do is believe. Say, Lord, I say yes. And I know you'll do the rest. And if we can wake up with that attitude every day, Lord, my life isn't perfect. I'm waking up. I know it's not perfect, but it's perfect with you because you're perfect. And so when I reshift how I think about the Lord, I know that, you know, out of everything that I'm trying to do in life, at the top of that list, Lord, you are my exceeding great reward. And as people of God, let's remember that. I may have to go to work. I may have to take care of my family. I have a lot of responsibilities like we all do. But Lord, you are my exceeding great reward. Just you and me, I win. And so we begin to reshape how we think about life, how we think about our situation. He says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all everything else will be added, all these things will be added unto you. So we begin to become a people who is chasing after him, who's seeking after him. I love you. I can keep going because I get excited. But I love you. Pray for me and my family. I'm so glad that I'm back healthy. I was down a little bit. I didn't know what it was. It was a little stomach something. It just kept lingering around, and I was like, oh, Lord, what is this? But I thought I lost my appetite, but I kept eating. Because I like to eat. I did. I just kept eating. But then I'd eat, and I was like, oh, my stomach don't feel well. And then I go to bed. I'm like, oh. And then I wake up in the morning. I was like, oh, my stomach don't. And it was just like on and off all day for like a week and a half, almost 2 weeks. You know, I prayed over. My wife prayed over me. I think even my kids prayed over me. I did what I have to do in every situation. I just put my trust in him. And you begin to remember that, you know, tomorrow's not promised to no one. It's not promised to any one of us. And so every day that I wake up, I have a new appreciation for life and the gift that God has given me. Lord, you've given me the gift of life again today. I am not going to waste this day complaining and worrying. Lord, I'm going to have the best day ever in you. And I thank you for the gift of life. Even though my life may not be perfect, there's somebody somewhere that would trade places with me. They'd be like, don't even tell me your situation. I'll trade with you. Just because I know where I'm at. And so whatever we are dealing with, it could look different. Y'all don't know this, but I had an accident a couple weeks ago, right at the beginning of all this stuff where my stomach wasn't right. And I shared this with someone today, but God just, and I shared it with, I think, Brother Shaddy a few days ago, but I jumped out on the highway. I was on 68. I was floating, cruise control, of course, and I was probably doing, I don't know, 55, almost 60. Had my praise music on. I was just, like, relaxing, going down the highway. There's no traffic lights. I'm on 68. I'm on the highway north of Urbana. And all of a sudden, out of my peripheral vision, I just see something out of the split peripheral vision. I look, and right as I look, this big buck with antennas and everything was right in front of my truck. Boom! I didn't even have time to stop. I just, boom, hit it, that thing, that deer, slid about 50 yards out, spinning around on the road. Like you ever took a domino or something and spin it, like that thing was spinning and then went off on the other side of the road. And I was like, wow. I didn't really feel it in the truck so much. I didn't have time to even hit my brakes. So I just slowed down and I pulled over and I sat there and a couple lady pulled up and she was with her husband. The husband was driving. They pulled up beside me. She said, are you okay? And I said, I was still in my truck. And I was rolling down my window. I was like, yeah, I'm okay. And then she's like, did you see that deer? And then I just started laughing. I laughed for about 3 seconds. I said, no, ma'am, I did not see the deer. I did not. I wish I had him, but I didn't purposely hit the deer. No, I didn't. And she's like, well, do you need help? I said, I don't think so. I got to get out and see the damage. So I got out and I walked around to the front of the truck and I was just hoping I was going to get around there and it was just going to look like all shiny and nothing. Like I got around there and looked and it was all exploded and just shattered and dented and everything. I was just like, and for a second or so, I was like, now why did this have to happen? And then something just came over me right in the middle of that. And I said, no, hold on a second. I said, Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you take care of those who belong to you. And I thank you that this was not worse than what it is, that I wasn't even harmed. I didn't even feel it, that nobody else was involved. It didn't cause any other cars to run off the road. It didn't hit anybody. Nobody else was injured. Lord, I just thank you for your goodness. I can get this fixed. I got insurance. But I thank you, Lord. And right in that moment, for the first time, I never hit a deer like that before, ever in my life. I killed it and my truck's all messed up. And so you don't know how you're going to react. Don't ever say what you'll never do. You don't know until you go through something. But what you do know, and this is, you know, this is relevant, can't nothing come out of you that ain't in you. I didn't have a curse word that was even in my mind. I didn't even think about that. I wasn't all angered up. I was perplexed for a second, like, why did this have to happen? And then all of a sudden, something came over me, and I took on an attitude of gratitude. And I was reminded that, Lord, you are good. You're working things out. This could have been a lot worse. There are people that have encountered a deer that didn't survive it. Deers are nothing to play with. They're big, and this is a season where the fields have all gotten plowed, where they used to kind of hang out. Now all those fields are down, and so they have limited space. They're out. They're mating. There's all sorts of things. So I just say, be mindful of that and keep your eyes open. But I took on an attitude of gratitude, and I said, Lord, thank you. I thank you. And I believe that's the way God wants us to approach everything. It doesn't matter if you go to work tomorrow and no one wants to go in here. And I've been through that where I've gone in and, you know, they say, hey, we've downsized and, you know, your position was impacted. God wants the people that was like, all right, great, where's my stuff? And walk out and say, Lord, I thank you. I thank you. It's in you that I live and move and have my being. I am not worried. You will take care of me. I thank you. Because we have this expectation that he is working and fighting for us. And so I've asked God to give me that type of spirit. And it doesn't just automatically come. You first have to have the desire. And then you have to know what the promise is. So you have to get into the word. I have to get in. And I know a lot of scriptures. You know, not more than Pastor Micah or more than Brother Anthony or some of our other brothers and sisters. I don't know them all by heart. But I'll go in and I know how to find him when I need him. And I know how to encourage myself and I know how to be reminded of his goodness. And if you go there and you start to praise him, you start to sing and you step outside of your situation for a second, your whole perspective will change. And you can have joy every day. You can go to bed at night and say, Lord, I love you. What an awesome day in you. And I look forward to what you have in store for me tomorrow. Because I walk in you and I walk by faith. I am not walking by what the news is telling me. I'm not walking by what the media people are saying. I'm not walking by what the health professionals are saying. All that stuff has its place. But Lord, first and foremost, I'm walking by what you say. I believe in you. And so that governs my attitude towards life. That's why I have a pep in my step. Because God is good and He is always taking care of his people. And so you have the same, and many of you do, but you have the same ability, and many of you already do that. But if you don't, if you find yourself feeling like you're getting beat up, just go to his word. Remember who you are in Christ. Remember who he is. And then begin to rejoice and give God praise. And you'll see how our faith will please God. He'll act on our behalf. And he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Love you, folks. Love you, family. Love you. Thank you for your prayers. I know many of you are praying while we were sick. And it's about 8:27. It's time to go home. You guys have a blessed night. And we'll come back together this Sunday. Amen? All right. Lord, bless our people, both those that are here, those that are not here. Bless our family, both locally and abroad, around the world and around the country. We say thank you, Lord, for all that you are to us and who you are. We're thankful for everything. We're not going to worry about anything. We're going to continue to pray and give you the glory as the King that you are. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.